ஆழ்வார் திருவடி கணேசரணம், எம்பெருமானார் திருவடி கணேசரணம், பிள்ளைலோக்காச்சாரியர் திருவடி கணேசரணம், ஜீயர் திருவடி கணேசரணம், ஜீயர் திருவடி கணேசரணம், முமுக்ஷுப்படி இஸ் அ பியூட்டிஃபுல் கிரந்தம் கிவன் பை பிள்ளைலோக்காச்சாரியா. ஹி ஹேஸ் கம்போஸ்ட் தி மோஸ்ட் இம்பார்ட்டன்ட் பிரின்சிபல்ஸ் which are explained through Rahasya Trayam in this Mumukshupadi. Pillalokacharya is greatly glorified for his Jnana Bhakti Vairagyam. He was a renowned Acharya, living for more than 100 years. He oversaw and led our Sampradayam for a very long time. Remaining in Sri Rangam, he had many wonderful disciples who all subsequently carried forward the Sampradayam principles and spread them everywhere. In this Mumukshupadi, we have seen up to the fourth sutram so far. In the first four sutrams, Pillalokacharya has explained the purpose of this particular grantham, that is, in the first sutram he explains that each mumukshu should know about the three rahasyams, and in the second sutram he explains that Tirumantram is the foremost among the three rahasyams. In the third sutram he explains that one should practice this tirumantram with great love and devotion, matching its greatness. In the fourth sutram Pillalokacharya explains how one should engage in this mantram. The acharya who gives the mantram and the object of the mantram, which is Bhagavan, how if one engages with great love, the benefit will be obtained in the expected manner. So these are the four sutrams we have seen so far. Manavada Mamnikal, who is Yati Punaravataram, that is Bhagavad Ramanuja's reincarnation, and Adishesha Avataram, he has given beautiful commentary for this Mumukshupadi Grantham. Without his commentary, it is very, very difficult to understand, rather impossible to understand the full meanings of this wonderful Grantham. So let us now move on to the fifth sutram. This fifth sutram is a very important sutram. In this sutram, Pillalokacharya explains the matchless greatness of this particular tirumantram and how it was revealed. By whom? All of these are explained in this sutram. First we will see the introduction section for the particular sutram. In the introduction, Pillalokacharya says that, Mamnigal says that Pillalokacharya is addressing the way this particular mantram was revealed, and in speaking about that revelation, Pillalokacharya is bringing out the greatness of this particular mantram as well. The sutram itself is a little bit larger sutram in comparison to the other ones. Let us see the sutram first. It is also very important for every one of us to go through the santai of the Mumukshupadi Grantham itself. It will be nice if we can familiarize the sutrams beforehand. We have the recordings and with the text also in YouTube. If we just spend little bit of time every day, we can familiarize the sutrams. We can even aim in such a way that before every session, at least we can try to cover a few sutrams which will be addressed in that particular session. We usually address about 2 to 3 sutrams only. So we can try to memorize those 2 or 3 sutrams from the recording so that we will have familiarity in the source text before we go through the commentary. This is the general practice in our sampradayam, familiarize with the source text before going through the commentary. So now let us see the sutram itself. சம்சாரிகள் தங்களையும் ஈஸ்வரனையும் மறந்து ஈஸ்வர கைங்கரியத்தையும் இழந்து இழந்தோம் என்கிற இழவுமின்றிக்கே சம்சாரமாகிற பெருங்கடலிலே விழுந்து நோவுபட சர்வேஸ்வரன் தன் கிருபையாலே இவர்கள் தன்னை அறிந்து கரைமரம் சேரும்படி தானே சிஷ்யனுமாய் ஆச்சாரியனுமாய் நின்று திருமந்திரத்தை வெளியிட்டருளினான். வெரி பியூட்டிஃபுல் சூத்திரம். Let us see the simple meaning of the sutram. Pililokacharya is saying here that samsaris, that is worldly people who are bound in this world, they forgot themselves as well as they forgot Bhagavan, Ishvara, and they also lost the opportunity to serve Bhagavan, and on top of all of this, they also do not have even a little bit of sorrow for having lost all of this. And in that particular state, they are drowned in this ocean of samsara, in this deluge of samsara, and they are suffering greatly in it, and they don't even know that they are suffering. At this particular stage, Sarveshwaran, Bhagavan, who is the Lord of all, out of his own compassion, to ensure that they all understand about Bhagavan and they all reach the shore of this particular ocean, he himself appears in the form of a disciple as well as an acharya, teacher, and he reveals the Tirumantram. This is the simple meaning of this particular sutram. Now let us see the commentary given by Mamunigal. For each section, Mamunigal has explained the meanings so beautifully. So he takes, that is the greatness of Mamunigal. He doesn't leave any word even. Even a single word, he takes that and he explains why that particular word is in place there. First he talks about samsari. So here he is explaining who is a samsari. Samsari means one who is in this world, samsara, and he is having avidya, karma, vasana, ruchi, all of these. And all of these are happening because he has connection with Achit, with matter, that is this Prakriti, that is this world, samsara. Since time immemorial, there is no beginning, it is anadi karma. This connection with world, this samsara, for the atmas, all the atmas, it is anadi, there is no beginning for that. We cannot say that atma was somewhere else before and then he came to samsara. That is not possible, because there is no other place. There are only 2 places. There is Sri Vaikuntham, Paramapadam, and there is samsara. If someone was in Vaikuntha, there is no scope for a person from Vaikuntha to come to samsara. It is just not possible as per Shastram. So the only possibility here is the Atma being here since forever, basically. There is no beginning, so we cannot say since beginning. Forever the Atma has been in this world only. And he has been going through this pravaha rupa, avidya, karma, vasana, ruchi, and so on. This pravaha rupa means it is a continuous stream. It has been coming, this avidya, ignorance, karma, all the punya and papa. Vasana. Vasana is impression, that is impressions in the mind which are coming naturally. And then there is ruchi. Ruchi is taste. We eagerly desire to get something. That is the difference between vasana and ruchi. Both are impressions and both are somewhat we can say taste. But vasana is more inbuilt and natural. Taste is more acquired. Like for example, we like someone may like some food item. They may know that it is not good. So even after knowing, if they like it, that means it is ruchi, it is taste. But if it is happening unknowingly, then it is vasana. So all these four, avidya, karma, vasana, ruchi, they are with the atmas. All the atmas have this. And due to all of this, they are going through janma, marana and other klesham, other sufferings. Janma is birth, marana is death. And then in between there is janma, mrityu, jara and vyadhi. There is old age and then there is disease. So these four are happening again and again for the atmas. So these atmas who are bound in this material world, in this samsara, they are known as samsaris. So Mahamunigal first explains the word samsari and then he is going on to the next section, which is Tangalayim Ishwaranim Marande. Here he is saying the samsaris have forgotten self and Ishwara. Now why Pililokacharya has put the word forgotten instead of saying not knowing? So not knowing will be more apt, because if one is in samsara, that means he has not understood Bhagavan at all. But if he is saying forgotten, that means previously he had known, but now he has forgotten. Now he is not knowing. Now, for that, Mahamunigal is explaining nicely that because this sambandham with Bhagavan is natural, this there is a particular quote here, Dasabhuta Svatasarve Hyatmanaha Paramatmanaha Nanyata Lakshanam Tesham Bande Mokshe Tadaivacha. There is a particular quote which explains that this Bhagavat Sheshatvam, that is being servitor of Bhagavan, is a natural quality of all Atmas, whether they accept it or whether they accept it or not, whether they realize it or not, it is a natural quality. Because of that, that is considered as one reason. Because it is a natural quality, Pillalokacharya is saying that natural quality has been forgotten here. So even though one has been in samsara, even then one is a servitor of Bhagavan only. Either Atma is serving Bhagavan directly in Vaikuntham, or if they are engaged in worldly activities, they are going to be serving Bhagavan through his agents. Bhagavan has body, many different types of bodies. There is devata bodies, there is materialistic entities, everything has Bhagavan as antaryami. So at the end of the day, every Atma is serving Bhagavan directly or indirectly. So in this aspect only, Pillalokacharya has put the word marandu, that is forgotten. There are other quotes also, Patim Vishwasya, Bhagavan is the Pati, Lord of all the universe. And then there is Swamitvam Brahmanisthitam, Swatvam Atmani Sanjatam, Swamitvam Brahmanisthitam. That is, Atma is eternally a servitor, Bhagavan is eternally the owner. So there are many pramanams which are existing to prove that Bhagavan is the natural Atma, natural Lord of all Atmas. Because of that, here Pillalokacharya is using the word marandu, that is forgotten. But in reality, it is that in it is actually not knowing at all. It is not that once he has known and he has forgotten. But there is a possibility. Maybe some person has known Bhagavan and then he has forgotten in multiple subsequent births. But it need not be a common thing for everyone. So that is explained here. So that particular section is explained. Next, Ishvara Kaikeyate Milandu, that is explained by Mamunigal. So because of this agyanam, this avidya, the ignorance, the Atma is losing its opportunity to serve Bhagavan. Bhagavan is the natural Lord and Atma is the servitor. Naturally, it is the servitor. He is the servitor. So the servant has to serve the Lord, serve Bhagavan. That is his Purushartham. Purushartham means the goal of the Purusha, the Atma. So naturally this Purushartham is a rightful activity for the Jivatma to serve Bhagavan. But he has lost it because he has been in ignorance. Hence here it is saying that Ishvara Kaingaratim Ilandu. So Ilandu is a very strong word. It's like he is totally lost it. He is completely missed out on it. So it is like a very impactful word. So that is why it is explained that Bhagavan being the Lord and all the Atmas being the servant, they have the natural right to serve him, but they have lost it here. And then next section is Irandom Engira Yidom Indrike Samsar Irandom Engira Yidom Indrike. Now the next portion is not only the Atma has lost it, but he is also not knowing, not realizing that he has lost it. It is like total ignorance, where not only that proper Purusharatham is missing in the intellect of the Atma, also the person is not even aware that there is such scope for service. It is like, for example, in the Puranas, I think there is a particular reference where once a particular set of devatas like Indra and other devatas, they were cursed to be born as pigs or something along that lines. So when they are in the mud and when they are in the dirt, they don't even know that they are suffering. They are thinking that they are enjoying. So this can be even seen in any practical life situation. People may be unaware of their real nature, their true nature, and they are engaged in so many different activities, worldly activities, and they would not even think that they are missing out on something which is greater, but they will be happy in whatever position they are. Similarly, here the Atmas not only have lost the opportunity to serve Bhagavan, but they have also completely become ignorant of the fact that they are losing all of this. So they don't even have feel for that loss. So that is the next section. After that, samsara magira perum kadalile vilundu novupada. This samsara magira perum kadal, this samsara magira perum kadalile vilundu novupada means to suffer deeply in this great ocean of samsara. So here again Mamunigal brings out very nice quotes. Samsara sagaram goram ananta klesha bhajanam. So here it says that this samsara is a very cruel place. It is a place of great sufferings, and it's a sagaram. That means it's an ocean which cannot be crossed by any individual on one's own effort. So by saying sagaram, it is established that it is not possible for an individual to cross on his own. He needs some boat or something to cross the ocean. So here he is not the Atma is neither knowing self, is nor knowing the Ishvara, and he is also very ignorant about his own goal. And because of all of this, he is fallen in this samsara, where he is completely suffering in this particular ocean. This ocean itself, this samsara itself, the virodhi. So we have seen about the artha panchaka, jivatma swarupam, paramatma swarupam, upaya swarupam, pala swarupam and virodhi swarupam. Because here the atma does not know about the self, jivatma. He doesn't know about the paramatma. He doesn't know that there is an upayam, which is Bhagavan himself. And then he is also unaware of the goal. So because of all of this, it is just the virodhi, that is the samsara only on the rise and fully tormenting the atma. So this prapyasya brahmano rupam, that shlokam clearly explains the five different aspects which we all have to know, that is the artha panchakam we all have to know. And this artha panchaka jnanam is basically lacking in this particular atma who is suffering in this soul. So for that, seeing all of this suffering, the next section comes into place. Sarveshwaran tan krupayale ivargal tannai arindu karaimaram serumpadi. So Sarveshwara, Bhagavan, who is the Lord of all, here each of the word also is very very impactful. Pillalekacharya is saying Sarveshwaran. Sarveshwaran means here he is explained about all the atmas which are suffering. By saying Sarveshwaran, he is establishing that Bhagavan is the Lord of all. So he is naturally having compassion and care towards everyone. So he is making his own efforts to help them, reach the shore. So that is what his compassion is coming into place and acting now. So Bhagavan is trying to now give this artha panchaka jnanam, this knowledge which will help them realize themselves, will help them realize about Bhagavan, which will help them realize about upayam and then upayam and virodhi. So he is, out of his compassion, he is coming to reveal the confidential rahasyatrayam, the meanings of the rahasyatrayam, and with that they can reach the ultimate goal. So that is being explained here. So now he is going to talk about Tirumantram, because the particular context is on Tirumantram, Bhagavan revealing Tirumantram as Narayana Rishi to Nara Rishi. So he is saying that this Tirumantram is Sakala Shastra Sangraham. All the essence of Shastram is present in this Tirumantram. So this Tirumantram being revealed by Sarveshwara is explained further. That is the introduction section for the subsequent portion of the sutram. So Sarveshwaran Tant Kripayale. So here another pramanam is quoted by Pillaloka Manavada Mamunigal. Isheshidavya Sambandhathu Anidham Prathamadapi. So due to the relationship, Bhagavan has the relationship with all the atmas. Seeing that relationship of him being the owner and everyone else being the owned property, he is, out of his compassion, he is giving this knowledge to everyone. So that is the reason for his kripa. Why is Bhagavan having compassion? Because he has a natural relationship with all the atmas. It is because of his natural relationship. Just like a mother will have a natural love towards her child, Bhagavan also has natural love towards all the atmas. So even though they may not like him, they may not understand him, they may not have devotion towards him, he still tries to help all of them. So another pramanam is quoted here explaining this principle from Ahirvidnya Samhita. Evam samsruti chakraste brahmyamano swakarma bihi jive dukkakule vishnoho kripa kavyupajayate. So Bhagavan acquires this great compassion in his heart towards the jivatma. This happens frequently. As soon as he looks at the world, this samsara, he becomes very worried. Why are all these atmas suffering? So at that time, a special compassion appears in his heart, and then he tries to help all the atmas at that particular time again. So every time this keeps happening. So it is his compassion, it is his causeless mercy or unconditional compassion, which is the main reason for the upliftment of all the atmas here. So that is Sarveshwarantan Kripayale, out of his kripa. And then the next section is Ivargal Tannayarindu Karamiram Serumpadi. Now all of these atmas who are suffering in this samsara, for them to understand, to realize about self as well as Bhagavan, and for them to know that Bhagavan is the only means through which they can cross this ocean of samsara. So for that, Bhagavan is helping them. So for them to realize, that is what Tannayarindu Karaimaram Serumbadi, that is for them to realize about the true nature of Bhagavan and reach him. For that, Bhagavan is helping them. There is another pramanam which is quoted here. All of these are very beautiful pramanams. Like, we can see how Mamunigal is quoting so many pramanams and establishing whatever Pillalokacharya, each word said by Pillalokacharya is supported by a very relevant, a very exact pramanam. For example, when Pillalokacharya says, out of his compassion, then Mamunigal quotes Kripaya Kapi Bajayate. When Pillalokacharya says, Karamaram Serumbadi, that means reaching the shore, then here another quote which says, Vishnu Potam Vina Nanyati Kinchidasti Parayanam. This, the boat of Vishnu is there for them to cross the ocean. So every word is given a sufficient, a proper quote from Shastram to prove all of these points. That is the importance of this commentary. Without the commentary, we will see, we may still understand the simple meaning of the sutram. Just by reading the sutram, anyone who knows Tamil can understand a little bit. In some cases, even that will be difficult. There are complex statements. But in most cases, we may be able to understand the simple meaning of the sutram. But the impact of the sutram, the purport of the sutram, and the relevance through Shastram to the particular sutram is beautifully brought out by Mamunigal here. So here the particular quote from Vishnu Dharmam is Samsarnava Magnanam Vishayakranta Chetasam Vishnu Potam Vina Nanyati Kinchitasti Parayanam. Here the Pramanam, this quote, this shlokam says, those who are sinking, drowning in this ocean of samsaram and are caught by this worldly matters which are like crocodiles, it is not possible for them to reach the shore on their own. They can reach the shore only with the help of the boat of Vishnu. Vishnu himself is the boat. Here the example is very, very nice. In worldly example, boat is an object which goes from one place to another. There is an ocean and boat is there. Boat goes from starting point to ending point. But the boat of Vishnu, Vishnu Potam, is such that because he is pervading, he does not go anywhere. He is all pervading. Now he takes the atmas who climb on him and he transports them to the other shore, to Paramapadam. So it's a nice way to look at how the Vishnu Potam works. Vishnu, the boat of Vishnu works. So that is Karemaram Serumbadi, that is to cross over the ocean. Now this next section is Tane Shishyanamai Acharyanamai Nindru. Here it is explained that Bhagavan himself remained as the Shishya and Acharya. Bhagavan is taking two incarnations here, Nararishi and Narayana Rishi. Narayana Rishi is the Acharya, Nararishi is the Shishya. Nara is a representative of human, Narayana is the representative of Bhagavan. So both these incarnations occur in Badrikashramam, and in this Badrikashramam, both of these rishis, Nara Rishi and Narayana Rishi, they are meditating and they are performing tapas, and Narayana Rishi is giving the meanings of Tirumantram. He is giving Tirumantram, Ashtakshara Mantram, along with its meanings to Nara Rishi. So that is explained here. Tane Shishyanumai Acharyanuman Indre. So he is actually quoting a shloka, a pasuram from Alvar's Sri Suktis. Naranarayananai Ulagattu Aranul Singama Virithavan. This is Tirumangi Alvar's pasuram, where he says Bhagavan revealed the beautiful Tirumantram in the form of Narayana Rishi to Nara Rishi for the benefit of everyone. So that is Tane Shishyanumai Acharyanumai Nindru. And then finally Tirumantrathai Veliyittarulinan. Finally here it is saying that Bhagavan revealed Tirumantram, Ashtakshara Mantram. Now this Ashtakshara is Sakala Shastra Sangraham, as we have already seen, and the essence of all Shastra is Artha Panchaka Jnanam, that is knowledge about self, knowledge about Bhagavan, knowledge about the means to reach Bhagavan, knowledge about the goal, and knowledge about the hurdles. So this is the Artha Panchakam, Swaswarupa Jnanam, Paraswarupa Jnanam, Upaya Swarupa Jnanam, Upaya Swarupa Jnanam, and Virodhi Swarupa Jnanam. All of these need to be understood. This is the essence of Shastram. And these Artha Panchakam are revealed very clearly, Suspashta, in a very clear way in Tirumantra, he says. Mamunigal says that in Tirumantra, Artha Panchakam is clearly revealed. And that Ashtakshara, that Tirumantra, was revealed by Bhagavan. Now, he could have said, here it is, Pillilokacharya says, Veliyittarulinan, that means revealed. Veliyidal means, in Tamil, it is just very, very simple explanation for publishing something. So, publishing or revealing, that is what is Veliyidal means. So, here, instead of saying, Bhagavan created or Bhagavan explained it brand new, the word Veliyidal means here it is revealing what is already existing. So here Bhagavan is not constructing something new and giving it to Nara Rishi. As Narayana Rishi, he is simply revealing what is already present. So that is a very important aspect for us to understand, that it is this Tirumantram also, just like Vedam, it is also always existing. It is not something which is created newly and given to Nara Rishi at that particular time. It was always existing. He is just revealing it. And out of his great compassion, here he is revealing what is very, very confidential, very, very secretive. Until that time, when Narayana Rishi instructed it to Nara Rishi, it was kept very secretly. It was only at that time revealed so that everyone becomes aware of it. So Bhagavan does it looking at the suffering of all the Atmas. He is unable to bear the suffering. So he is here revealing the already existing Tirumantram to Nara Rishi in the form of Narayana Rishi. So this is the fifth sutram. It's a very elaborate sutram and a very impactful sutram, which highlights how this particular Tirumantram was first revealed. First revealed means in every creation. The Srishti and Stiti and Layam keeps happening. In every one of that Srishti, Bhagavan reveals this Tirumantram to Nara Rishi, so that this gets propagated subsequently. And many Atmas benefit out of it. So that is the fifth sutram. Now we will move on to the next sutram, which is sixth sutram. In this sutram, in the introduction, Mamunigal explains nicely, is it not sufficient if Bhagavan just stays as an acharya, a teacher, and just reveals it publicly or just documents it somewhere. Why he had to incarnate as both acharya and shishya? What is the purpose of being the shishya? It is understood that he likes to be acharya. That is why he assumed the first acharya position. He is the prathamacharya in our sampradayam. So it is naturally understandable that Bhagavan is the prathamacharya. So he remained as the acharya and he revealed it. Why did he himself have to come as shishya? Either he could have just spoke it and documented it, or he could have chosen someone else to learn this from him. So somebody else, some jivatma could have been made as shishya. Then that is also fine, right? So here Pillalokacharya is explaining why Bhagavan himself had to remain the shishya, and is explaining the reason for that in this sixth sutram. So sixth sutram is Shishyanai nindradu shishyan irukkum iruppu natar ariyamayale attai arivikkaga. So simple meaning for this sutram is Bhagavan remained as the shishya as well. That is because the people of this world did not know how to behave like a shishya, a proper disciple, how to remain like a disciple. They did not know. So to show that himself, he remains as shishya and gets this meaning from Bhagavan himself. So Bhagavan assumes the form of acharya as well as shishya to show that even to remain as a shishya, there is a lot which is required in the individual, and that quality need to be shown by Bhagavan himself. That is a simple meaning for this particular sutram. Now we'll see the commentary, Vyakhyanam of Mamnigal for this particular sutram. Mamnigal again quotes many beautiful pramanams for this particular sutram. Many supporting evidences are given by Mamnigal. So here, not only Bhagavan remained as the acharya, he also remained as the shishya. The reason for this is, as explained in beautiful pramanam which is quoted here, astiko dharmashilascha shilavan vaishnava shuchihi gambiras chaturo dhiraha shishya ityabhidhiyate. So here it is saying, in this shlokam, it is said that how a disciple should remain. The shishya first should remain as an astika. Astika means one who has faith in shastra. Generally we may think that astika means one who is religious or one who has faith in God and so on. But the direct meaning of astika means one who accepts shastram as a valid entity, valid pramanam. Only those are called as astikas. It is a corollary that one who accepts shastram will naturally accept Bhagavan also, because from pramanam only we come to know about Bhagavan. So it is naturally understood that astika also accepts God, but the main foundational meaning for astika is having faith in shastram. So a shishya must first be an astika, must have full faith in shastram, and then he must be desirous of engaging in righteous activities, dharma. He must be having interest in engaging in the dharmic activities, and then he should have the conduct which matching all of that dharma shastram. So that is what shilavan means. So dharma shilascha, and then shilavan, and then vaishnavaha. He must be a vaishnava. He must have Vishnu bhakti. So in Alavanda Stotratnam it is said that kaha vaidikaha. So who will, if one does not have Vishnu bhakti, or if one who is a firm vaidika, one who is a follower of Vedas, how can he refuse, how can he reject the supremacy of Vishnu? All of the Vedams are talking about supremacy of Vishnu. If one is a vaidika, that means he must accept Vishnu as the supreme. There is no question about it. So Vishnu Bhakti is very, very essential to become a Shishya. And then Shuchihi, that means he must be pure, both internally as well as externally. And then Gambirha, he must be very deep. He must see the depth of all the principles. Chaturo, he must be very, very capable of doing activities. Very smart and intelligent. He must be Dhiraha, he must be very confident in whatever activities he is carrying out based on Acharya's instructions. So all of these are termed as the qualities which are required in a Shishya. So who will have these qualities in full? Only Bhagavan has all of these qualities. All the qualities which are highlighted in Shastram is fully possible for Bhagavan to practice all of this. So he himself appears as Shishya. Then there are other quotes also. Shariram Vasu Vijnanam Vasaha Karma Gunanusun Guruvartam Dharayedyastu Shishyo Netaras Smritaha. So a Shishya must have or must give everything, his body, his wealth, his knowledge, his dwelling place, his activities, characteristics, everything must exist for the sake of his Acharya. Only such person is called as Shishya. He who is different from these, he cannot be called as Shishya. So here again, the qualities of Shishya are explained by Mamnigal based on Shastram. So because oftentimes we question Acharya, why he is not doing that, why he is not doing this. But we also have to self-introspect. Are we acting like a Shishya properly? Are we acting like a, for example, Ramanuja Sambandhi? Are we acting like a Vaishnava? So we should also introspect and see if we are able to follow any of these. So all of these qualities are expected in a Shishya. And then there is also another quote from Nyasa Vimshati. Sadbuddhi Sadhu Sevi Samuchita Charita Tattva Bodha Bilashu. And in this shlokam also, this is from Nyasa Vimshati, which is Nyasa Vimshati is by Vedantacharya. He also explains how a disciple should be very knowledgeable, very sincere, very much affectionate towards Acharya, should have Shamam and Dhamam and all the other qualities. So all of these are explained in Shastram. So one should have, so based on all of these, it is explained that one should have Sadhyantara Nivritti. One should not have any attachment in any of the upayams, any of the means, other than Bhagavan as the means. This is why no other processes, no other extra karma or vrata or any of these are supported to be performed by Sri Vaishnavas. Palasadana Sushushai, one should engage in service to Acharya. One should have arti, that is deep desire to reach Paramapadam. One should have adharam, that is one should have great attachment. Anasuya, one should not have any jealous at all towards Bhagavan and Bhagavatas and Acharyas. So all of these are expected in Shishyas, and because this Shishya Lakshanam is not seen in any of the people in this world, if Bhagavan just explains through Upadeshams like he did in Bhagavad Gita, many may think that he is doing all of these advice and instructions only to bring out his own greatness. He is just remaining in the high platform and he is just instructing others. But has he followed any of these? So to make sure that people don't question him, he appears as a disciple and he follows all of those principles properly, and then he shows that, look, I am able to follow myself, so you should be able to do it also. So if he instructs simply and not remaining as a disciple, then people will say he is just doing it for increasing his own greatness. So to avoid that, he is doing it through anushtanam. He is showing all the principles how a disciple should be through his own anushtanams. So by seeing that someone is practicing it, then others will feel, oh look, yeah, somebody is able to follow all of these principles, so we should be able to also follow the same. And saying that, they will start following the principles and become a proper disciple. So this we can see even today, if people just instruct and not have anushtanam. This is why Manavar Mamnigar says, jnanam anushtanam ivai nandragave udayanana. A disciple, an acharya should have both jnana as well as anushtana. If you just have jnana and not have anushtana, then people will say that you are just instructing, you are not inspiring me to follow any of this. So unless jnanam culminates into anushtanam, unless, for example, we hear that we should not worship devatantra, devi devatas, then it should culminate into practice. We should not worship. Whatever advice we heard, we should practice. Similarly, if we say, if it is said that we should develop vairagya, then we should develop vairagya. It says that we should not engage in other upayams, then we should not do it. So there is jnanam aspect and then there is anushtanam aspect. Both of these aspects are required in the disciple. To manifest, to show that all of these are required and they are not just theoretical, Bhagavan himself appears as a disciple and he shows all of these in practice and makes others also follow them and practice them. So that is the sixth sutram. With this we will complete this session. ஆழ்வார் எம்பெருமானார் ஜியர் திருவடிகளேஸ்வரனும் ஜியர் திருவடிகளேஸ்வரனும்.
To learn such valuable information about our Sri Vaishnava Sampradaya, please download Koyil, K-O-Y-I-L app from Google Play Store or Apple App Store. Our website is koyil.org, K-O-Y-I-L.org.